Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT classes. So as you have seen that we have started the 8th standard history book in our last class. So today we are going to start with our second class for the class 8th history NCERT book. Okay, so in these lectures we are basically covering the NCERT books, right, on the day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube. And you will get the daily current affairs as well as daily or NCERT related classes also. So you can subscribe our channel and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. All right, let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so the first is basically the ruling the countryside. As we have seen that the East India Company have basically set up their foot on the Indian subcontinent. Okay, and what happens is on 12th August 1965, okay, the Mughal Emperor basically appointed the East India Company as the Diwan of Bengal. Okay, so after appointing the Diwan of Bengal, the company have the tremendous power. Okay, so the company has the financial powers. So it become basically chief financial administrator of the territory which is under control of the East India Company. And moreover, the company does not have any responsibility but to use the wide amount of the powers. Okay, this basically begins, you know, the East India Company to colonize our country. So they started basically organizing the revenue administration or revenue sources, specifically from the West Bengal. And then later, over the period of the time, it basically covered the throughout the country. Okay, they also started changing the rights of the people with regarding to the revenue administration, with regarding to the other affairs. And also they started, you know, the changing of the rights of the people, right? How to produce, what to produce, right? Because they also interested in the basically the revenue they got from such crops also. Okay, so as you have seen that the revenue of the company basically are mainly focusing on, you know, the financial administration where it was appointed as a Diwan of the Bengal, okay, by the Mughal Emperor. So the company basically, you know, become a Diwan, but still it was a trader. Okay, so before 1965, if we came, right, we have seen that the company used to purchase the goods from the India. Okay, now how the company used to pay before 1865, the company used to pay these goods, okay, by importing the gold and the silver. That means the company used to pay, or you know, pay those purchased from the India basically in terms of the gold and silver that will be, you know, imported from the Britain. Okay, now the revenue which is being collected by the East India Company after appointing the East India Company as a Diwan of Bengal, okay, obviously the revenue itself is sufficient to purchase the goods for your export. So that means now there is less need, or there was no need to import the gold and silver in order to purchase the goods from basically from the India. So that was a first case that was there. Okay. And that has led to the Bengal economy, which was completely in the plunge. That means the Bengal economy completely facing a deep crisis because of this. Okay. And in 1770, what happens is, right, this is 1765. This is 1765. Okay, so what happens is in 1770, there was also a terrible famine, right? There was insufficiency in terms of the food grains. What happens is 10 million people were killed, right? So 10 million people were killed specifically in the West Bengal region. Apart from that, this was the crisis which was made by the East India Company specifically in the Bengal, right? So obviously there was need to improve the agriculture, because now company was also interested in basically in taking off revenue from the farms also, or from the crops also, right? So the company introduced the permanent settlement. Okay, we will learn the features about the permanent settlement in the next few slides. So the company introduced the permanent settlement in 1793. Okay, and in that permanent settlement, right, what happens is a zamindari system was introduced. So what happens is the Rajas and the Talukdars, right, were recognized as the Zamindars. right? Now, obviously, the zamindars used to pay, right, the amount to the company. Now, what happens is the numerous zamindars were there, right, as they were recognized as a zamindars. They basically, you know, these zamindars were sold off at the auctions, right, that were recognized by the company, right? If the particular zamindar, right, who failed to pay the required amount of revenue to the company, okay, such zamindar would be lost its zamindari, you know, rights. So that means even if the zamindar do not pay the required amount of the revenue to the company, right, that will be sold to the person who have through the auction, who can give the company as the highest amount of revenue. So that means the old zamindar may lost its zamindari if we fail to, you know, pay the required amount of revenue to the company. Okay. And moreover, the zamindars were not interested in the importance, basically, in the improving of the land, because the zamindars are more important, basically, you know, in collecting of the revenue. So they were basically, the company were asking from the zamindar, you pay the revenue, required amount of revenue to us. The zamindar in turn basically forcing the farmers to pay more and more. Okay, in turn, what happens is the cultivators or the farmers were basically exploited, right, in the hands of zamindars. And the zamindars used to pay, right, and a fixed amount of, I don't know, some money to the company. And in that process, what happens is ultimately the farmers used to exploit. Okay. And moreover, these zamindars are not interested in improvement of the condition of the land, right? So that was also one case. So what happens is the new system was devised. So by early 19th century, okay. So many of the company's officials, basically, they have convinced that, right, the revenue system that is there in terms of your permanent settlement need to be changed. Okay. So that something needs to be changed. And in that process, in the early 19th century, right, the Englishman called Holt McKenzie, right, the Holt McKenzie basically devised a system which is known as Mahalwari system. Okay. This Mahalwari system was basically came into effect from 1822 onward. Okay. So after, you know, after explaining or after, you know, looking into the permanent settlement, their pros and cons, their drawbacks, right, they have started introducing a new system that is called Mahalwari settlement system. Okay. Then the Munro system came. We will learn what is Mahalwari system, what is permanent system in the next few slides. Okay. Then the Munro system was basically devised. Okay. So what will happen is that the British territory, specifically in the southern India, okay, the new system was devised. Okay, that was called the Rayatwari system or Rayatwar system. Rayatwari is basically, you know, directly farmers. So that Rayatwari system was initiated by Captain Alexander Reed, okay, and that was developed by Thomas Munro. This system basically extended all southern India. So that means that southern India, there was Rayatwari system, okay. But now you must understand that whatever the system the British basically deduced, okay, that was not at all sufficient. Okay, now the Britishers wanted to increase the more and more income from the land, okay, and the revenue officials fixed too high as a revenue demand, right? Obviously, if they fix too high revenue, obviously the farmers cannot pay the money, right? If the farmers cannot pay the money, what will happen, right? The villages basically deserted in many regions, right? So the riots which was there, they fled, right? So what happens is they left because the peasants were unable to pay. So there was basically, you know, the greed of the Britishers could not fulfill because of such systems also. So let's understand some of the basic features of this permanent system, Rayatwari system and Mahalwari system. One by one, we will learn. Okay, so first is permanent settlement. What is permanent settlement? As I told you that the company or the East India Company introduced this permanent settlement in 1793. Okay, so at that point of the time, it introduced this permanent settlement. Okay, and as I told you that the Rajas, Talukdars were basically appointed as a zamindar. Okay, so they were asked to collect the rent directly from the peasants. Okay, and in turn, these Rajas and Talukdar, which were recognized as a zamindar, they have to pay the revenue to the company. Okay. And that revenue that these Rajas and Talukdars were recognized under permanent system, this revenue or the amount that has to be paid were fixed permanently. Okay. So that revenue was fixed permanently. Okay. But you must understand this permanent settlement that was basically, you know, was fixed, was basically very oppressive for the cultivators, because these zamindars or these persons, Rajas and Talukdars, who were appointed as a person to collect the revenue, right, they used to collect more and more as much as they can, because they have to pay a fixed amount. Okay, they have to pay a fixed amount to the company, and whatever the excess they collect from the farmers, they can take that one with themselves. So they was basically in that intention of collecting more and more. So that was the effect on the cultivators or effect on the farmers related to the permanent settlement was very, very negative. It was very oppressive system. Okay. The rent they paid to the zamindars were very high. Okay. And their right on the land was also insecure, because now the new one that is, you know, the Rajas and Talukdar were basically recognized as a mediator to collect the rent, right, from the peasants and pay back to the company. Okay. Let's understand the Mahalwari settlement. Okay. Mahalwari means it's a basically village or a group of village. Okay. So this Mahalwari basically is introduced by an Englishman, which is known as the Holt Mackenzie. Okay. This new system was introduced, right? And it came into force in 1822. That is in early part of 19th century. Okay. Now, these collectors who were basically assigned to collect the revenue, they were asked to visit the villages. Okay. And directly the Mahal means it's basically a group of village or villages. Okay. So these collectors used to visit the villages. Okay. These collectors used to inspect the land. Okay. So they used to inspect the land. Okay. They measure the field. Okay. They record, they check all the records in terms of their produce, in terms of their customs, in terms of the rights of the people. And based on that assessment, based on that inspection, okay, the estimated revenue of each plot was added up. Okay. So they basically, you know, bring some estimated revenue from each plot that can be generated out of such one. And that is calculated that each village or mahal had to pay. You're getting my point? So they used to village a particular, they used to visit a particular village that is known as a mahal. Mahal means a village. Okay. So a village wise revenue is basically collected by, you know, by the basically Britishers. Now what happens is every such village is assigned a one collector. Okay. These collectors used to visit the villages, right? They inspect all lands. They measure all sort of, you know, fields, their produce and all sort of customs and rights and different peoples, right? And based on that assessment, they basically estimate some revenue that can be generated. And by adding all peoples within a village, right? So that is a cumulative or sum total of revenue that can be generated from a particular village or a particular mahal that has to pay. Okay. And that demand was revised periodically. That means it was not fixed, unlike, you know, your permanent settlement. Okay. But this demand was to be revised periodically. So that was the case that in the Mahalwari system, the demand was not fixed. That can be revised periodically. Okay. Then Rayatwari system, as I told you that the Rayatwari system was basically there specifically in the southern India. Okay. So British territories was there in the southern India that was known as the Rayatwari system. Rayatwari means directly farmers. So they used to collect revenue directly from the farmers. So this was initiated by the Captain Alexander Reed. Okay. And that was developed by Thomas Munro. Okay. And this system gradually extended, right, to all parts of southern India. Okay. And as I told you that Rayats was basically cultivators, right? So this in the Rayatwari system, directly revenue is basically collected from, you know, cultivators directly. So in the Rayatwari system, the revenue is basically directly collected from the rayers or from the cultivators. Okay. Then let's understand the changing in the pattern of, you know, cropping pattern specifically in India. Okay. How the different crops being demanded from India, right? So what happens is by the late 18th century, okay? Now the company was basically trying to expand the cultivation of opium and indigo because that was very high demand, okay? So they tried to expand the area under, you know, opium and indigo, okay? So in that process, what will happen? The Britishers basically, or East India Company officials, they forced the cultivators to produce these opium, indigo also. And also, there was also demand for the jute, pea, sugarcane, wheat, cotton also. So Britishers basically forced the cultivators to produce this jute, pea, sugarcane, wheat, cotton, rice, and they introduced several of such new crops in the Indian subcontinent also. Okay, now, what happens is indigo that was basically forcefully cultivated in India. So there was rich blue color. Okay, this rich blue color is commonly known as indigo that you have seen also. Okay, now this blue dye, right, is basically used in the paints, specifically in the Morris paints in the 19th century. Okay, and this was manufactured from the indigo plants. So that was the reason that to manufacture this blue dye, which is used in the Morris paints, is basically used to get from the indigo plants. All right. Now, the Britishers basically forced the Indian cultivators to produce the indigo. Right. So that was the at the point of the time when Britishers forced the India, okay, Indian cultivators, the India was become the biggest supplier of the indigo in the world in 19th century. Right. So that was a condition in the 19th century, when the rich blue color or the blue dye, which was in great demand, specifically in the Britain. Okay. Now, why the demand for the Indian indigo was high? So as you have seen that, right, in the 13th century, right, the indigo was basically used by, you know, cloth manufacturers in the Italy, France, and the Britain to dye the cloth. So obviously at that point of the time, the Indian indigo was very famous. Now, this indigo produces a rich blue color that is basically grown in India. Okay. And, you know, the dye, which is basically used from the another plant, right, was very dull, was very pale. That was not rich blue. So that was the reason the demand for the Indian indigo was very high. Okay. And the indigo plantation also came up in many parts of North America, which also slowed down the demand basically from the India, but still the demand from the indigo was basically very high. Okay. Now in that case, the British basically turns to India. Okay. And now Britishers basically force the cultivators to expand the area under indigo cultivation. Okay. The idea was to meet the rising demand for the indigo in the Europe. So the Britishers want that the Indian farmers should grow indigo, okay, in order to meet the rising demand for the indigo in the Europe. Okay. And it was basically a commercial, aspect here. So what happens is the indigo trade basically, right, because the company started investing in the indigo production itself, because there was huge profit margin, right? There was huge profit margin specifically in the indigo, specifically in the indigo cultivation. So that was also reason that the commercial agents, officials also started, you know, investing in the indigo production also. Okay. Regarding demand for the Indian indigo, so India has also, you know, better suitable environmental conditions, better weather conditions. Okay. So these suitable weather conditions, environmental conditions for the growth of indigo was the main factor behind the growth of the indigo in India. Okay. And as I told you that it was the French, you know, Italian, Britishers, European, all were basically used to use the Indian indigo, specifically for dyeing the cloth. Okay. So it was in the great demand, specifically from French, Italian, you know, European, to use that Indian indigo, right, for dyeing the cloth. Okay. And this cloth manufacturers basically favored the indigo against the wood plant. Okay, so that was the reason behind the high demand of the Indian indigo, specifically in the Italy and in the French region. Okay, now the cultivation of this indigo, which was carried out in India, was carried out under two popular systems. Okay, that two popular systems were known as the Nij system and the second is the Rayati system, right? So there were two popular systems for cultivation of indigo. First is Nij system. In the Nij systems, what happens is Nij matlab its own. So that is, right, that is my own. So Nij system means the cultivators or the farmers used to grow their indigo on their own land, right? So they were forced to grow, okay, the indigo on their own land. That was Nij system. Okay, what is Rayati system? In the Rayati system, it was, you know, the cultivators or you know the growth of the indigo used to be done on the rented land. Okay, and that too, the hired laborers were basically hired for the working on this rented land, and the produce is basically exported to the Britain. So in the Rayati systems, right, the rented land was there. Right, it is being worked upon by the hired laborers, and then the produce will be sold or produce will be exported to basically to the, you know, to the European countries as well as to the Britain. So that was the condition when such system was basically devised. So there were two systems, okay, Nij system and Rayati system. Okay, so now let's understand the problem with the Nij cultivation. So the problem was Nij cultivation was basically, since the Nij cultivation means the growth or the growing of, you know, the indigo, right, on personal land. Okay, that means on the farmer's land. So that was the aspect of the Nij cultivation. Obviously, the biggest hurdle was the expansion of the area. That was not possible because whatever the land was available with the cultivators, they can cultivate only on those land. Okay, and moreover, the Indian, you know, the farmers are basically small and the medium. Okay, so what happens is there was 85% of the land holdings basically, or the farmers are basically small farmers or medium farmers. So obviously there was cottage plots which were available. Okay, and mobility of the labor was also very, very slow. Okay, and also there was problem related to the growing season of the indigo, which was clashed with the rice cultivation in India. Okay, so there was a trade-off what to produce, whether rice was basically staple crop, okay, that has to produce, or the indigo used to produce for the gains of the Britain. Okay, so that was the case. So, you know, that was the case, and that has led to, you know, the most important aspect of the problems in the Nij cultivation. Okay, next, the indigo on the land of Rayans. Okay, so that was the growth of, you know, the indigo on the lands of the Rayans, specifically in the Rayat system. So in the Rayat system, now what happens is the planters, right? Planters means who basically invest in the planting of indigo. Okay, they force the Rayats to sign a contract. That was a forged deal. Okay, so they forced the Rayats or the cultivators to sign a contract or an agreement which is known as Satta, or which is known as Satta, right? Those cultivators or those Rayats which signed this contract, right, what they get, they got the cash advances from the planters, because planters are basically used to promote these, you know, these indigo on the land, right? So they were basically eligible, or the planters were basically, once they signed it, or the contract between the Rayats and, you know, the planters, the Rayats or the cultivators would be eligible to get the cash or the revenue, or basically the finance from the planters at a very low rate of interest, right? But the condition attached that whatever the revenue that they are getting, right, from the planters, these Rayats should only produce indigo. So that is basically the attached, right, you know, conditions, that whatever the revenue, whatever the finance they are getting, okay, they used to use this finance only to produce indigo. Okay, and the peasants got very low price for the indigo they produce. So whatever the maximum profit out of such production, right, out of such production of the indigo, right, these planters used to get the major amount of revenue. And the peasants got very, very low price for the indigo they produce. And this happens, this cycle of loans never ended. What happens is, for example, if this is the planter, okay, the planter gave loan, okay, that is the finance, okay, to Rayats, okay. The Rayats think that they are getting the loan, right, at the low interest rate, they will produce, okay, and ultimately they will sell in the market and they will get revenue, okay, or they will get basically the resource, and then ultimately they will repay. What happens is, this when they sold this basically the indigo in the market, they get very less amount of, you know, return. So the indigo was sold with very low price, so they get very low amount of return, and they were unable to pay this loan which was taken from the planter. And now what happens is, since they are not taken, again they took the loan. So, right, again they did not repay, again they took the loan. So what happened, this cycle of the loan never ended. Okay, this cycle of loan never ended. And what happens is, this has led to the burdening of, right, the Rayats specifically from the loan amount. Okay, and after the indigo harvest, the land could not be sown with the rice, which peasants also preferred. So that was also there, right? So that was also there. Next, your Blue Revolution. Okay, so Blue Rebellion. Let's understand about Blue Rebellion, right? So what happens is, in 1859, okay, because of such oppressive practices related to, you know, the practice of the indigo, which was basically cultivated, right, in the on the Rayats land. Okay, this has led to the thousands of the Rayats in the Bengal refused to grow the indigo. Okay, that was the reaction, because they are under debt trap. Okay, and this rebellion basically spread. Okay, and Rayats also refused to pay the rent to the planters. They completely refused that they won't pay any rent to the planters. And what happens is, they also started attacking the indigo factories, indigo promoters, indigo planters, and etc. Okay, and the Rayats also, they swore that they will no longer take the advances to sow the indigo. Okay, and they will not come under any sort of a pressure, or they will not be bullied by the planters with the lathiyal. So they basically used, you know, basically their own defense mechanism in order to counter the planters' lathiyals also. Okay, and ultimately what happens is, when this when this rebellion was spreading, right, with one very high scale, the government basically set up an indigo commission, right, to inquire into the system of indigo production, whether it was oppressive or whether it was based on, you know, certain aspect, right? So the government basically set up this indigo commission. Okay, and this commission declared that the indigo cultivation was not profitable to the Rayats. Okay, and hence they could refuse to produce the indigo in the future. Okay, so this has led to much greater respite, okay, to the indigo cultivators or to the Rayats, because the commission was also gave, you know, the recommendation in favor of the Rayats also. Okay, now what happens is, after the revolt, because this revolt has led to the setting up of this indigo commission, which has ultimately led to the favorable, you know, the recommendation in favor of the Rayats. So after revolt, the indigo production basically collapsed, right? There was reason that the farmers basically, or the Rayats basically, refused to produce the indigo, right? Now the planters now shifted their operations to the Bihar. Okay, now they have shifted that all such operations would be carried out in the Bihar. Okay, next, your tribals, Dikus, and the vision of golden age. Okay, so that was a time when the time was mid 1870s, when Birsa Munda, okay, so Birsa was born in the families of Munda. This was basically a tribal community, okay, or a tribal group that lives in the Chota Nagpur Plateau. Okay, so Birsa Munda was basically, you know, a basically charismatic leader. okay, and under the Munda tribe. So the tribe have various customs and the rituals, as you know. Okay, these customs and the rituals are basically very different from, you know, from those which are led by the Brahmins, because whatever apart from the tribals basically, or are led by the customs which are basically, you know, led by the Brahmins. Okay, so what happens is the tribals used to live in the different part of the country, specifically in the isolated environment. So they never come and they mix with the mainstream society. Rather, they used to prefer lives in the jungles, in the isolated pockets, right, in the lush green forest, okay, where the human reach is not possible. So they used to have their own, you know, practices, customs, rituals, and etc. Okay, now some of these tribals used to practice the zoom cultivations. What is zoom cultivation? See, zoom cultivation is also known as shifting cultivation. Shifting cultivation ka matlab hota hai, it is also known as slash and burn agriculture. Okay, so slash and burn. Okay, what happens is these tribals, suppose this is the land. Okay, these tribals used to go, and these tribals used to cut these trees. Okay, they burn it. Okay, and whatever the ash which is generated over there, they use this ash to basically increase the fertility. They grow the crop. They grow the crop over this land. And after 2 to 3 years, they basically abandon this land. They abandon this land. Okay. And they move to the new land. Okay. And after the new land, again, they do the same thing. They cut the land. They cut the forest. They burn the forest. And they basically use the ash to increase the fertility of the soil. And they grow the again forest for 2 to 3 years, and they again, you know, abandon this land also and move to the third place, like that. So this is called slash and burn. That is called shifting cultivation. So that is every time they cultivate, they used to shift, right, their piece of the land. So that is, they was used to done on the small patch of the land, mostly in the forest areas. Okay, so cultivators, what used to do, they used to cut the tree tops to allow the sunlight to reach on the ground. Okay, then they burn the vegetation on the land to clear it for the cultivation. Okay, now once the crop is ready or harvested, they move to the another field, right? And they follow the, you know, they used to have the similar practice, and they used to have the practice of fallow. Fallow means just simply leaving the land, in order to recoup its own fertility. Okay, so that is called fallow. Fallow land, that means you just leaving the land without cultivation, right, in order to increase the fertility of the land naturally. That is called the practicing of the fallow. Okay, now some of these you know, tribals were basically hunter and the gatherers, as you know, right? Some of these basically people used to live by the hunting of the animals, right, gathering of the forest produce, like, you know, plants, timber, right, the fruits, vegetables, they used to collect, roots, etc. Right, the khons were basically also tribal group. They were basically hunter and the gatherers, lives in the forest areas of Orissa. Okay, and they use many such forest shrub, herb, right, specifically for the medicinal plant, because they were totally dependent on you know, the basically on the forest for their sustenance. Okay, and they used to sell this produce in the local market also. So there were different adaptations basically adapted by, you know, by those tribal peoples in the tribal societies. They used to practice those such adaptations also. Okay, then you have the Begas. The Begas is also one such tribal communities, right? They used to reluctant to do work for the other. Okay, so the tribal groups often needed to buy and sell in order to able to get the goods. So they used to have certain set of, you know, the practice in which they used to sell their produce, right? And then in turn they used to get some others produce. Okay, so they have certain set of barter system in which they used to exchange the items. Okay, those items which are not produced within the locality, that is called barter system. Okay, they used to exchange, right, from those locality, right, specifically on those products which are not grown in the local area. This led to the dependence on the traders and the money lenders, specifically for these practices. Okay. Then some were basically herded animals, for example, right? Some tribal groups have, you know, the big herd of animals. They used to rear the animals, okay? And they used to go and basically in search of pastures, right, to the different places, right? They used to gather the forest produce also. Many people or many tribals were basically pastoralists, okay? So what they do, they used to move with their herd of cattle, okay, or group of cattle. You might have seen also, depending on the seasons, right, depending on the pasture which is available on the particular land. So they used to move with their herd of the cattle or the sheep. Specifically, you have the Burl Gujjars of the Punjab region or the Punjab hills. Then you have the Lavadis in the Andhra Pradesh are basically cattle herders. They used to move with a group of their cattle, okay? Then Gaddis of the Kullu were also the shepherds, okay? Then Gujjars in the Bakarwal of the Jammu and Kashmir also reared the goats. They used to move with their herd of animals from one place to the another place in search of the pasture, in search of, you know, the green food for their animals, okay? And some of these tribal people basically took to the settled cultivation. And they started doing, you know, practicing the, you know, growing of the crops also. So they started doing settled cultivation. That means instead of moving from the place to place, they basically settled at one place. Okay. And they started growing the crops also. So that was the case. Okay. So many tribal groups basically began to settle down instead of moving from one place to place. Okay. Now they use, you know, the practice which were used by the farmers. So they started using the plow, right, to plow the field. Okay. They gradually got the right over the land there they live. Okay. And, you know, the Britishers also, you know, saw these settled tribal groups like Gonds and Santals are more civilized than the hunter gatherers and the shifting cultivators, because now they are still not adapted, you know, this form of cultivation, which is known as settled cultivation at one place, right? So these Gonds and the Santals, which were more civilized in terms of, you know, this settled cultivation, they started, you know, settling at one place, started living at one place instead of moving from one place to another place. Okay. The most important point is how did the colonial rule affect the tribal lives? Okay. So the tribal lives were basically changed during the British rule. That we have to see how the tribal life basically changed. So what happens to the tribal chiefs? So what happens is before the arrival of the British, okay, now the tribal chiefs, what tribal chiefs used to have tremendous power. So they enjoyed all of economic power, you know, the political power, administrative power, because the tribal chiefs, just like a king, they used to enjoy the wide range of powers. They have right to administer, right to control their own territories. They enjoy wide economic powers. Okay. Now, whenever the British came, okay, the Britishers expanded their rule. Okay. Now, what happens to the functions and the powers which was there with the tribal chiefs? Now they changed. Okay. Now, what will happen? They change. And this has led to, you know, the changes in the land titles. Okay. And they were forced to follow the law which were made by the British officials in India, okay, which has led to the tribal agitation. You might have seen also in your modern history book, which has led to the tribal agitation. Okay, the tribals also, you know, agitated, right, or rebellion started specifically in the tribal regions because of such interventions done by the Britishers specifically in the tribal land. So this was also, you know, one of the important factor why the tribals basically agitated. Okay. Now what happens to the shifting cultivators? Because as you know that the new land reforms or new forest laws came into picture. So British were basically very uncomfortable with the shifting cultivators because they used to move from one place to another place. Okay. And moreover, such shifting cultivation did not give the Britishers a revenue source, a fixed revenue source or regular revenue source. Okay. And Britishers were more interested in getting, you know, a fixed set of revenue or the, you know, regular revenue sources. So they introduced the land settlement that we have seen, the permanent settlement, Vaidwari settlement, Mahalwari settlement. Okay. So that was basically introduced. Okay. Now, the British's effort to settle the Zoom cultivators was not very successful because such people also did not want to settle at one place. Okay. So after facing a widespread protest, right? So Britishers basically allowed them, right, to carry on the shifting cultivation in some parts of the forest because they did not succeed in controlling the basically the shifting cultivators that were basically practicing the Zoom cultivation specifically in the deeper part of the forest. Okay. Now, this has led to the Britishers basically, you know, enacted the forest laws. Okay. Now we have to see what was the impact of these forest laws on the life of tribals. Okay. So the tribals' life is basically directly connected with the forest because they were totally dependent on the forest for their sustenance, for their food, for their economic returns, for their everything. They are dependent on the forest. Okay. Now the Britishers extended their control over all forest and declared them a state property. That has led to the restriction on the right of the tribals specifically over the forest areas. Now, the reserve forest, right, which were basically, you know, the Britishers want to control over there because these reserve forests used to produce the timber. Now, if the Britishers want to control them, obviously they will have to conflict with the tribal people. Okay. And in the reserve forest, as you know that, everything is prohibited, so the people are not allowed to move freely or practice Zoom cultivation. So that was also affecting those tribal people, right, which were basically moving freely in the forest areas. And also some of the Zoom cultivators which used to practice the shifting cultivation also. So they affected both the tribal people as well as the Zoom cultivators, right? And many tribal groups basically reacted against, right, such, you know, colonial forest laws, and which is basically led to the rebellion, okay, to basically, you know, to those, you know, especially in those tribal areas. So that is there that, you know, that has led to the rebellion of these tribal people, specifically with the reaction of such, you know, the forest loss. Now, there was also related to the problems related to trade also. Okay. Now, in the 19th century, the tribal groups found the traders and the moneylenders were coming into the forest. Okay. Because these traders and the moneylenders used to give the money to the tribal people, to the cultivators, and basically, you know, get the rich returns in return. Okay. Offering the cash loans to the tribal people and asking them to work for the wages. Okay. Now, this has led also to the debt trap of those tribal societies also. The Indian silk was very high demand, specifically in the European market in the 18th century. Okay. The Santhal, which is a tribal group in the Hazaribagh, right? Now, they used to rear these cocoons, okay, which produce this silk. Okay. Now, these traders spent, right, their agents, right, who gave the loans to the tribal people and collected the cocoons. So it was a similar process to exploit, right, those tribal people, right, in terms of, right, giving loans to the tribal people and collecting, you know, basically these cocoons, which were basically producing this silk, because the silk was very high demand, specifically in the 18th century in the European markets, right? And moreover, the coconuts was also exported to the Wardhaman or Gaya, where they were sold at 5 times the price. Okay, so that was also the case. The Britishers used to, or the basically the agents used to get a lot of money. Okay, now the tribals used to search for the work. So the plight of the tribals had to go far away from their homes in search of the work. Even that was very worse. Okay. So the tribals were basically recruited in a large numbers for the teak plantation, because the tea was basically introduced and the basically people needed specifically to work in the tea plantations. So they used to go away from their lands. Okay. So they were recruited in the large numbers, specifically to the work in the tea farms, in the coffee cultivation, in the coal mining, right? Obviously on the contractual low wages. Okay, and that has led to the exploitation of those tribal people, and that too they were unable to return to their home because they were exploited in the hands of such exploitative practices. Okay, so in that return, the tribals, basically groups, rebelled in the different part of the country against such law which was made by the Britishers. So that was basically the law which was exploitative in the nature, restrictions which were basically, you know, related to the practices, okay, which was basically, you know, farm laws or the forest laws, which was basically in the form of reserve forest, right? New taxes which were implemented, which has to pay, okay, and exploitation in the hand of the money lenders, traders, right, also led to, you know, the rebellion among the tribal societies, okay. The Birsa Munda. The Birsa Munda was basically the greatest, you know, a hero, basically. And a movement related to the tribal movement was basically begin under the leadership of Birsa Munda, who belongs to the Munda tribe. Okay. The British officials worried about the political aim of the Birsa Munda. Okay. So the Birsa Munda wanted to complete expulsion or complete driving out of these missionaries, moneylenders, Hindu landlords, right, as well as the government, and set up completely the Munda Raj at Birsa at its head. Okay, so the Birsa Munda wanted complete removal of outsiders, whether it is a missionary, moneylenders, Hindu landlords, or whatever may be, okay, who is exploiting the basically the tribal peoples. And in 1895, the Birsa Munda was arrested by the Britishers, okay, and he was released in 1897. And again, the Birsa Munda basically toured the villages to villages to gather the support, right, in favor of this movement. And the Birsa Munda was basically a very charismatic leader. So he urged the people to destroy the Ravana, that was the Dikus and Europeans who were basically exploiting the tribal people and establishing the kingdom, right, under his leadership, right. And what happens is this movement did not grow well, because the Birsa Munda died in 1900 because of cholera, and the movement was ultimately faded out. Okay, but again, he has led to, you know, to basically the great effort to spread this movement specifically in the tribal region. Okay, so that's all for the today. So thank you very much. We will meet tomorrow for our next session. Thank you very much.